What's going on, guys? Welcome to the Peanut Gallery Podcast. This is the place that we provide our unprofessional and insignificant opinions about the most important and significant topics of the day. As always, I'm your host, Jared, and joined with me is Seth, and we have a pretty big show planned for you guys.
Quite a big show.
Yeah,
lots happened, man.
Lots happened.
Another busy week.
Yeah, gosh. Busy week, another week in the terrible, horrible, awful, scary Trump presidency.
The misogynistic, racist,
white privilege. Hold on. You didn't get all the buzzwords.
Buzzwords.
Keep
somewhere.
Going. Yeah, keep spouting them off somehow.
Yeah.
So a crazy week and a lot happened. And let's go ahead.
Let's just jump right into it, man.
Yeah, jump right into what was nuts this week. All right, guys, we are back, and we're going to jump right into the what was nuts this week. So first thing on the list, we got Rex Tillerson confirmed by the Senate as Secretary of State.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so that's pretty cool.
I mean, there's not much to say. I mean, he's confirmed. The one interesting thing is the votes against him was the most in the Senate history against the Secretary of State. So he had the biggest opposition. Surprise, surprise.
Yeah, I was about to say there's not much surprising about that. I think it's probably interesting, though, because there were a couple outspoken Republicans, such as Marco Rubio as a senator, who I know he voiced his opposition to him and said that he wasn't going to vote for him either.
I think he ended up voting for him, though.
Oh, did he really?
I'm not sure, though. Don't quote me on that.
Okay. Well,
but there's a lot of people that had issues, but confirmed, now we move forward and see how he does.
Yeah, we'll see what happens. I'm like we've kind of talked about with Donald Trump. I'm skeptically optimistic about the situation with his administration. So we'll see what happens there.
I'm supremely excited for the next topic. You know,
nice segues, killing it. Yeah, no. So the next one we're going to talk about is the Supreme Court pick. So this was a big deal for a lot of people because there are a lot of people who were on the fence about Donald Trump, and they were like, you know, the only reason I'm going to really vote for him is because of the Supreme Court. If Hillary gets in, she'll, you know, appoint a lot of more liberal left-wing Supreme Court justices. So this really was a big deal for a lot of people. He said during the campaign that he would appoint a conservative Supreme Court justice, and he has.
Which makes sense.
Yeah, exactly, and he's kept his promise. And a lot of people are freaking out about this, and I don't know why. It's dumb. I mean, he's replacing Scalia's spot, who Scalia was as Neil Gorsuch is the person who Donald Trump nominated, but he's replacing Scalia's spot. And how he described Justice Scalia was saying he's a lion of the law. He was obviously a very strict constitutionalist. He interpreted the Constitution as the founders wrote it, which is a very important factor to kind of take in, which
I think would
be common sense. Like, wouldn't everyone do
who
that?
Who wouldn't want that in the Supreme Court?
That. Yeah.
I mean, maybe the same nomination that thought the Supreme Court spoke for the people. That could be maybe someone that
LGBTQIA.
Wouldn't want that.
Yeah. I think this is great. This is good Trump, man. This is solid. This is a big deal.
This is good Trump. Good Trump.
This is good Trump. You never know which one you're really going to get. Typically, what he says isn't that good. What he does is better. This was good, and I'm glad. Good on him, and hopefully the Senate confirms it. We'll see. There's a lot of stuff going on about whether the Senate will filibuster this or not. If they do filibuster it, it would require 60 Senate votes to push him through.
Holy crap.
Which obviously the Republicans have 51 seats, so they wouldn't have a majority. However, there is what's called a nuclear option, which the Senate Majority Leader, which is Mitch McConnell right now, has the option to invoke. And what that does is that takes away the filibuster option permanently. So it completely takes it away. So the whole we don't really know if Mitch McConnell has the guts to really do that, if he wants to invoke that option, because then the filibuster is no longer something
he
that can happen.
He can't use it either.
Exactly. It can't be used at all. But we'll see. This likely will not be the last nominee that President Trump nominates.
Has.
Yeah, yep. Exactly, because,
he's set to have quite a few.
Years. Yeah, and if he stays in for 8 years, then he'll have, you know, up to three, maybe four nominees. So for them to freak out about this one isn't really the smartest thing for me, because like we said, he's replacing a conservative justice.
It's one of those you got to temper, like, if you're going to attack him when he's pretty – I mean, he's originalist. He's It's great. I mean, when there is someone that is worse, you're not going to be as valid, I don't think, because people are going to be like, well, you said he was bad and he's way better than him.
Exactly. And he was appointed back by George W. Bush in 2006 to the 10th Court of Appeals, and he was voted on there unanimously when Joe Biden and Barack Obama were senators at a time. Everyone voted for him to be appointed. So yeah. I think that's interesting to throw out there.
Mm-hmm.
Next
thing.
Yeah, let's move into the next one. So obviously the kind of standing acting attorney general, Sally Yates, was fired.
No longer really standing or acting.
Yeah. Why don't you run through this story, Seth?
Yeah, so this is Sally Yates. After a federal judge ordered a review of the policy, Yates announced that her staff at the Department of Justice would not seek to defend it in a court of law. Now, this is in regards to the immigration executive order signed in by Trump.
Yeah.
She said that she wasn't, quote, convinced that the defense of the executive order is consistent with these responsibilities, nor am I convinced that the executive order is lawful. So that's what she said. Now, since she said that, she was let go. I think she resigned of her own accord, but basically was like, you should get out. Or did they fire her?
Yeah, I heard they fired her.
Yeah, okay, maybe.
It makes her more of a hero, of a victim, that she was fired. She didn't resign. Yeah.
Yeah. And then the White House put out a press release or whatever that was saying, quote, the acting attorney general, Sally Yates, has betrayed the Department of Justice by refusing to enforce a legal order designed to protect the citizens of the United States, end quote. So that's kind of like scathing. Like that was pretty.
Yeah, no, I mean, whether you agree that the executive order was implemented to protect the United States or not, it is absolutely true that she did betray the Department of Justice in the sense that she did not enforce the executive order, which is her job as attorney general.
Exactly. Her job as attorney general is not to evaluate the wisdom of an order, but to enforce it when it's passed. And it was passed and it was legal. And her saying, I'm not convinced, you're the attorney general.
Figure out if it is constitutional or not. Go consult with some experts, some constitutional scholars, and figure it out. You can't just say, I don't really know, so I'm not going to enforce it.
And so, of course, the media is spinning this as anyone that disagrees with Trump or something he wants to do, he's just going to fire. It's like, no, she wasn't doing her job.
Yeah.
She can have a difference of opinion, and that's fine. But if she doesn't feel like she could enforce it, that's also fine. But at that point, she needs to step down because she is not able to do her job as attorney general, because there is no legal reason for this not to have been enforced.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was legal. It was passed. She can disagree with it. That's fine. But to say that her department's not going to do it because she's not, you know, I'm not convinced it's a good idea. No, that's not your job. You're not doing your job.
Yeah.
And so he's justified in getting rid of her.
Yeah, it was definitely
I stand on it.
Absolutely. It was well within President Donald Trump's means and inability to constitutionally fire the attorney general for that reason.
Exactly, because you can't just have – I mean, if he had –
You can't have someone who's not enforcing the laws that the president decides to enforce.
Because she's not convinced it's a good idea. That just opens the door for all sorts of manipulation that just we cannot have.
Yeah, exactly. And like you said, like she has the right to not want to enforce it, or if it conflicts with her moral obligation, she has more than a right to say, you know, I'm not on board with this morally, I'm not going to enforce it, so therefore I am going to resign.
I mean, I think they have the same thing in the military where, like, if you think an order is unlawful, you do not have to do it, but you need to step down.
But someone else will take your place.
Exactly.
Because like, it's going to happen regardless.
You can't just stand there and be like, no, I'm not going to do it, and then they continue to just let you do that. No, you need to take yourself out of the situation if it's going to be that big of an issue.
Yeah, definitely.
So,
definitely.
I mean, do we know who he's going to put in her place?
Yeah. This is Attorney General Jeff Sessions is still waiting to be –
Oh, because that's his – because she was still kind of
– Yeah, because this was – when President Obama – this is kind of confusing. When he obviously stepped out January 20th, all of his cabinet people who he appointed also did. So Loretta Lynch stepped down as attorney general. So she was kind of an acting one. So it's no surprise. And she was put in place by the Obama administration, but she kind of stepped up to that role. So it's no surprise that there'd be a conflict of ideologies there.
A little bit, yeah.
Yeah. All right, so let's move on to this next one. So this story is actually pretty cool. I like this one. Why don't you run through and tell us what happened here?
It's cool, but at the same time, it's kind of embarrassing because it kind of just shows that people outside of America understand what we're doing better than a lot of people inside of America.
This is true.
So the United Arab Emirates foreign minister, I'm going to try not to butcher this name, Abdullah bin Zahad Al Nahane.
That was perfect.
I think I nailed it.
That was perfect.
I think I nailed it.
I'm fluent in that language, and you nailed it.
Okay, cool. Yeah. So he said Wednesday during a joint news conference with the Russian foreign minister that Trump's order is, quote, within the American sovereign decision. He went on to say that there have been attempts to give the impression that this decision is directed against a particular religion, but what proves this talk to be incorrect first is what the administration itself says, and that this decision is not directed at a certain religion. I think you nailed it on the head. I mean, if you just read the frickin' order, man, it's never mentions religion once.
It doesn't. It doesn't even say the word Muslim in it.
It doesn't say the word Muslim. It doesn't say – all it says about people – give – what does it give? Express help for people being persecuted by a religion.
Exactly. And the top five most populated countries – of the Muslim belief are not mentioned in this pause or ban or whatever you want to call it. They're not in here.
It's only 7 out of like the 50 Muslim countries. And it's also important to note that the executive order, the countries chosen, were not chosen by Trump. Mm-hmm. The administration did nothing in choosing the countries. All they did was they took the top 7 countries that the Obama administration had assigned as having the biggest safety concern to the American citizen and implied a ban on them.
Yeah,
and
but that's not good enough. We have to protest. We have to protest in the middle
because
of
she hates immigrants. And it's like, no, it's for safety. I thought it was really cool that the United Emirates foreign minister was wise enough and smart enough, and it's awesome that he comes out and says it too. And it's just like, this is not directed at a certain religion. Like, just stop. It's not what it is. The order itself doesn't say religion. The administration has come out and said that it's not what that is. Yet no one listens to that, and they just want to be up in arms that it's a hatred of Muslims. And it's like, you don't understand what you're talking about. You make yourself sound dumb and ignorant when you don't just do simple things like read the order.
Yeah, no, definitely. It's another example of where we're praising someone for just really speaking common sense when it comes down to it.
Yes, you know and what I mean? Knowing what the heck they're talking
that we're
about.
At the point where if someone says something logical and reasonable, we have to praise it because it's rare these days.
I mean, I mean, when someone says something logical, I kind of want to protest, you know, because it triggers me a little
exactly.
bit. And so I feel like that's
it's
what
startling.
We do, right? We protest.
It's, yeah, well, professional victimhood. Very good.
Professional
You're doing
victim.
Well. You're doing well.
All right, cool. I want to jump into this last one, man. This last one I thought was really cool. Kind of scary, but also, I think, fascinating. So a Chinese company... they produce cell phones and technology, like little electronic stuff. Replace 90% of its workforce with automated machines, robots. So they went down from 650 people to 60 people in this factory, and production went up 250%. How insane
crazy.
Is that? And then a lot of people thought, okay, well, production might be up, but I mean, what about defects? Well, defects have dropped from 25% to now 5%. So they're creating over double the amount of stuff with a fifth of the defects.
Of the defects. That doesn't make sense why they would think that with machines there would be less.
I think
defects
that was a last ditch
people.
Effort to try to keep the jobs.
Yeah,
like,
it's a kind
well,
of
you know.
Achievement.
But I think this is
well,
awesome.
Well, those Chinese people can go work for Apple now for $2 an hour.
There you go.
Oh,
that's going to be automated too, though. But this is, I mean, honestly kind of scary when you think about, I mean, Trump's platform was bringing back these manufacturing jobs to America.
Yeah.
I don't think they're going to be around that long.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Like, people
those
that
jobs
want
are
just,
going away anyways, in my opinion.
They're the ones that are going to be the things that are simple, mindless. Those are the quickest things to be automated.
Yeah. And then more those jobs will be taken away, and then certain jobs will be created and maintaining mm-hmm. the machines and creating the machines and stuff like that, which is obviously a more skilled profession. But this is crazy, man. That's a huge increase in production.
From
and you 90%. Can't really fault a business for wanting to do that.
They even said they could see it going down to 20 people maintaining the facility.
Yeah.
So that's from 650 to 20. That's insane.
With a 250% increased production.
And think about it. The way technology works, I would imagine that number can go up.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Like with efficiencies
the more proficient
and new
the
machines
and stuff get.
Yeah. I'm going to be interested to see if more of this starts happening, if that cost savings is then transitioned to the consumer. Because they're producing a lot more. they're having to pay a lot less people. I wonder if that is going to make cheaper products.
Or if the products are going to make
higher margins.
Or the profit margins would just be higher, but then they could maybe invest in other companies or something. The money's got to go somewhere, but if it actually correlates into producing some more jobs, you know, that's obviously yet to be seen.
Yeah.
But no, it's interesting. I think the moral of this story is that machines are just better than people, you know?
Yep.
Just create. Oh,
I mean, let's, machines don't protest, so.
Yeah, exactly. They just do what they're told. Wow, how nice would that be? Gosh. Just make people into robots. The world would be a better place.
There you go. iRobot.
There you go. All right, guys. Well, we're going to go ahead and move right into the main topic this week. All right, guys. We are going to jump right into the main topic this week, and we're going to be talking about free speech.
Or the lack thereof. This whole thing is kind of started about us wanting to talk about this with the riots that occurred in Berklee College a few days ago. Milo Yiannopoulos, who is a journalist, entrepreneur, author, public speaker, self-proclaimed troll, was on a tour around campus colleges and doing speeches, doing like talking with the students and. Some people didn't like that. He's a very polarizing figure. He's super alt-right, very pro-Trump, and honestly, he's just kind of a jerk, and he's just I can easily see why people don't like him. The problem was, though, that when at Berklee College, the night he was supposed to be there, there had been peaceful protesters all day, protesting him coming, not wanting him to come do the speech and stuff, saying it's like inhumane, it's just hate speech, and hate speech isn't free speech. But what really got out of hand, because that's fine, peaceful protesting is fine, what got out of hand were when a small group, a quote small group is what has been reported, when you watch the videos, I don't necessarily think it was a small group, but a group of people dressed all in black, hooded sweatshirts, freaking went on a riot at this school. Smashing windows, smashing ATMs, spray painting, assaulting people that wanted to hear Milo speak. There's video that you can see here of a woman getting pepper sprayed in the face.
I'm looking to just make a statement by being here, and I think the protesters are doing the same. And props to them for the ones who are doing it nonviolently, but I think that's a very rare thing indeed.
Just because he thought she had a Make America Great Again hat when she didn't. It was a parody hat. You see there were people getting beaten on the ground. It got so bad that Milo's...
Oh, this stuff makes my blood boil, man.
Right, dude? It got so bad that Milo had to be evacuated with the police department. The police department shut it down because they said they could not contain the situation and they could not guarantee safety for both the speaker and the attendees. Of course, the school has come out and said that we, quote, condemn in the strongest possible terms the violence and unlawful behavior that was on display and deeply regret that those tactics will now overshadow the efforts to engage in legitimate and lawful protest against the platformers' persistence and perspectives. They also continued to say that while Indianapolis's views, tactics, and rhetoric are profoundly contrary to our own, we are bound by the Constitution, the law, our values, and the campus's principles of community to enable free expression across the full spectrum of opinions and perspectives. So that's really cool, I think, for the school to say that.
I agree with that last statement, but then also I was reading it and I was thinking, why does a public university like Berklee College claim to have their own views? It seems weird that they say
values.
Values, obviously, like you have a code of conduct and stuff like that. But in this sense, they're strictly talking about political views. And when Ben Shapiro goes to these, because obviously he's been boycotted and there's been riots in his name and stuff too. And the schools will specifically say the speaker does not associate with our views. And I thought to myself,
everybody has to have a political opinion now.
Yeah, but it's a public university. I feel like its views should be made up.
Public or private?
No, it's public because
it's public. Okay.
Yeah, we'll talk about it later. Talking about defunding.
Oh yeah, his reaction.
Yeah, it's a public school, but I don't think that really public university. While obviously there's a code of honor and a code of conduct, they shouldn't necessarily be saying that this political figure's views do not line up with our political views.
Yeah, it does seem a little odd, but
but at least they came out and said that. they are bound by the Constitution and law to at least have it.
Yes. And so that's where the issue and what we wanted to talk about was the fact that these rioters and these cowards that were hiding behind masks that caused so much damage to the school, for what purpose? When you react to freedom of expression with violence, you failed. When you can't engage in a rhetoric,
absolutely,
and instead you decide to attack physically, that's when you know things are starting to fall apart. And it's very – and, dude, the worst part is, honestly, to me, there were celebrities that were praising this.
Oh,
yeah. Sarah Silverman said it was awesome. We need to join the resistance. There was another female actress I can't remember that said that it was good what they're doing.
No, there was a representative in Florida who specifically said that the rioting and everything like that was a beautiful sight.
Like, no, I'm sorry. It's not.
How is vandalism and violence –
these are the same people that think it's okay. People,
lighting things on fire. How's that a beautiful sight?
It's the same people that think it's okay to punch a neo-Nazi in the face. Yeah. That one guy that got punched in the face on camera. Like, I don't agree with that at all. But he is allowed to say that. And when you start attacking them, that shows that you don't feel like you can or you won't engage and have a conversation and just destroy him with facts and destroy him in a conversation and show him why his views
disprove
are wrong. Punching
it with
him in
logic
the face
and common reasoning.
Punching him in the face and lighting McDonald's on fire and breaking Wells Fargo vending machines.
I don't know, man. Lighting McDonald's on fire, that's justified, you know? I mean, that'll cause McDonald's, that'll bring about change.
Yeah.
No, you're definitely right, because when you punt, like, obviously I don't agree with anything that the neo-Nazi or anything like that was saying. However, when you get to the point where you think it's justified to punch somebody like that in the face for just, you know, displaying their opposing views, then you run down a very slippery slope where, oh, I don't agree with this person. Maybe it's okay to punch them in the face.
I'll just assault them.
Maybe it's okay to put this person in prison because I don't believe – I don't, associate myself with their beliefs. So it's a very slippery slope. And the
dangerous.
Exactly. And the Constitution very strictly states out what it believes about free speech and hate speech, like it or not, is covered in that. Death threats and threats towards people's health and well-being are not. I wouldn't consider it. I mean, you could consider it hate speech, but
what they've shown is that hate speech itself is covered. It's not illegal. Hate speech in and of itself is not. There can be hate speech that is, however, not allowed and is unconstitutional. When it's a threat, when it's incitement, when you're doing it intending violence, no. But just saying something and expressing your opinions, no, I'm sorry, that is
that
covered.
Is lawful. And
you frankly might not like it, but that's what makes America great. I mean, like, it's always been great about this is because you can have these separate viewpoints. Like, my neighbor can think this thing, I can think this thing. Guess what? I'm not going to punch him in the face. He thinks that, I think this.
Exactly. And frankly, I mean, speech that you disagree with is the most important speech to be protected, because if you agree with everything people are saying, obviously it's not, you know, you don't really have to fight that hard to protect it. You need to fight hard to protect against the speech that you don't necessarily agree with, so that if you want to have an opposing viewpoint, then you can say it freely without, you know, having to be punched in the face. But yeah, no. So like we were talking about, the Constitution very strictly lays out freedom of speech and how we protect it. It's the First Amendment. There's a
little
reason.
Bit.
There's a reason it's the first one. But yeah, no, it says right here, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or of the right to assemble. So it strictly says there it covers freedom of speech, freedom to assemble, freedom of religion. These are all, you know, very important things that are encompassed all under the First Amendment. And they need to be protected.
They do need to be protected. And not letting Yiannopoulos in this situation talk to this school does nothing for helping doing these violent acts. And
it doesn't do anything. It doesn't do anything to help educate your students so that they can be kind of intellectually consistent
honest.
And strong in their beliefs. You know what I mean? We talked about this a little bit before. If you're never challenged on what you believe, and you know truths that you hold self-evident to your own self, then if you're never challenged on those things, then you never really have to fight for it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Debating
and that's how they grow.
Strengthens your what you believe, or it can possibly change your look on something.
Mm-hmm.
So,
very true. Yeah.
It's a mess, man.
Yeah. I mean, I love the fact that we can, like, for instance, with freedom of speech, we're allowed to do this podcast.
Yeah.
I mean, without it, someone or the government, if they didn't agree with us, or private, I mean, we wouldn't be able to just talk. And the fact that we can talk about this and maybe not everyone agrees with us, that's fine. We like that. I mean, if everyone agreed with us, like you said, would kind of not be fun, not would be exciting. It wouldn't be beneficial at all to just have one think, like everyone just group think.
Yeah.
I think there's also an important distinction to make, though, because Ianopoulos has been banned from Twitter multiple times, and I think permanently now because of hateful rhetoric and speech. Now, that is okay, because private organizations have a right to police themselves however they deem fit. Yeah. So banning him, so for like just saying,
this, however,
like,
is a public institution.
Exactly. So banning him on Twitter for hate speech is completely fine, because Twitter can do whatever they want with their platform. But trying to have him banned from going to a public college and talking because of hate speech is not okay, because that is covered by freedom of speech.
Exactly.
That is a public place. That is where, I mean, these
it's
are
a
when
public
young
institution
minds
that has a lot of funding. That comes from the government. And, yeah, like you said, I mean, these people's minds are being molded and stuff like that, and it's important for them to hear viewpoints from all different sides, really. I mean, when I've been growing up and even in college and stuff like that, I'll hear views from things that I don't agree with and things I do agree with, and I'm glad that I hear opposing viewpoints, because it strengthens my own in return.
Yes. And that's what one of the biggest reasons why I think safe spaces are such a bad idea is because the idea of restricting yourself from speech that you don't agree with is antithetical to the freedom of speech.
Yeah.
And the fact that you're just like, well, you know, in here, no one will ever challenge you. No one will say something you don't agree with. And then you like get in the real world.
That's how the
like,
real world
hey.
Works, right?
Yeah, I know, right?
You just kind of say anything, and people just kind of go along with it and are fine with whatever.
Well, no, how the real world works is when someone says something you disagree with, you go outside and you protest.
Yeah, or you call them a racist.
And you first call them a racist. That's true. That's number
and then
one.
You go protest.
And then you protest that he's a racist.
Rules of professional victimhood 101.
And that he needs to let your free speech happen. So it's very important to not try to silence people that disagree with you.
Yeah, no, and I think President Trump's response was very justified in this. Of course, he took to his favorite social media outlet, and he tweeted out and said that if UC Berkeley does not allow free speech and participate and practices violence on innocent people with a different point of view, no federal funds, all caps.
I don't like his tweet at all. I think it's completely dumb. It was wrong. They came out and they said that they are disturbed that this happened, and they wanted him to come because they are bound by the Constitution for freedom of speech. And so I think it looked him look stupid, because he obviously just reacted. He didn't see what they said. And
yeah,
I
think a big
really
thing
bad.
That he was responding to was Berkeley College was claiming that they couldn't contain the rioting and the protesting.
No, the sheriff
like
said they couldn't. The
police
department
the police station
said, they,
said
couldn't.
That they couldn't, which I think that they definitely could. But maybe in this particular instance, it might not have been the best use of judgment, which happens a lot with Donald Trump, unfortunately. But there have been universities and public universities that do not allow certain speakers. And so if that were to have been the case, which I guess they did let him. There was
they
just
wanted
rioting
him to
that
come.
Happened, so he wasn't allowed to come. But there have been other universities who haven't let them come in. So I guess if he had tweeted out about those, then I would have agreed. Then I would have said that that's a good thing.
Yeah, but this tweet was just completely wrong. And saying that they don't allow free speech, they do. And that the school practices violence on innocent people. No, these people did not go to school there. This was a group that they've been labeled, and they call themselves BAMN by any means necessary. They're not.
Sounds
it's
nice
not the school.
Reasonable.
It's not like a after school organization.
Yeah.
This is like almost a terrorist
it's not a club.
Organization.
It's not like the chess club.
It might be, dude. What if it's all just the kids that play chess?
Yeah, no, I get what you're saying. I absolutely agree with him. They did let him on to come and speak. Obviously, he just wasn't able to because of the protesting and rioting and stuff like that.
Yes.
And the police apparently weren't able to contain it, which is crazy. but for schools that haven't allowed speakers to come on there, I have no problem with federal funding being withdrawn. But in this instance, that wasn't the case.
No,
but
that was not the case.
It's
so sad that we've gotten to the point that opposing rhetoric is this demonized.
Yeah,
Like, because really, also, I mean, the
protesters. This has been a cornerstone of democracies in republics, man, is having hearing the opposing point of view. I mean, the root word in a civilization is civil. People have to be civil when they're communicating. You have to listen to people's rhetoric that you don't like, and other people have to listen to yours.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because guess what? Like, sense. I mean, you might think like, oh, I can't believe I have to listen to this guy. Well, guess what? What you're saying, someone probably doesn't agree with, and they are letting you talk.
Exactly. You know, and like, they're just saying their opinion. You
think of someone else.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, definitely.
And it's so angering. And the fact that people are starting to not be able to separate violence from this is scary, honestly.
Yeah, the mix that people are throwing in, you're justified to incite violence or punch somebody in the
face.
Yeah,
like, good job. You punch him in the face. Something. He was wrong.
Yeah, exactly. And honestly, this happens on the left, obviously, as we've seen, but it also happens on the right. When Donald Trump was talking and campaigning, he was talking about paying people's that he would pay their bills for punching somebody in the face, any kind of legal ramifications that would happen. So, I mean, when you get to a point where you're encouraging violence as an opposition towards somebody's speech, that's just a dangerous place to be in. And that's kind of like, that's kind of how fascistic governments. Yeah, exactly. You're getting really close to the line when you start punching mm-hmm. people in the face and rioting destroying things.
I really do hope, and I really do think that it's a vocal minority, and it's the people on the far left and it's people on the far right. And the majority of people that I think do land along that middle, leaning one way or the other, I really do think the majority of them still are civil and still are understanding and will agree. Like, they honestly,
the silent majority. Exactly.
But it's with this happening more often, I mean, it's going to be important for freaking celebrities and people that carry social weight to not praise these things, but to condemn them and to say, do not do this. Absolutely. This is a bad thing. Yeah. This is not what we do. Women's March was a perfect example. That was great. It was peaceful. Didn't agree with what they said, but hey, that's fine. I mean, I don't agree with it. Big whoop. Guess what? I just won't go to the protest.
Yeah.
Solved it. It's not that hard.
No, it's not enough.
And so it's just, I hope, I mean, people need to be condemning this and people need to be fighting this because it's not, I don't think Trump's going to tear this nation apart. I think this idea that violence is the answer and this idea that there's no real freedom of speech, that could be what destroys America because that is dangerous.
Oh, yeah. Donald Trump won't do it. We can do it by ourselves.
Oh, yeah. We're still.
Just as easily. But when I was thinking about this, I'm interested to hear your perspective on this, but do you think that this will be something that people kind of look back on and it almost kind of like, it was a rough spot in American history for a little while, but it almost kind of shows people how ridiculous it is in the long run? Like maybe
all
these,
the protesting or this specific incident,
just not this specific incident, but just all of the stuff kind of rolled up together, all the protesting going on at schools and just all the rioting in the streets and just basically the whole kind of idea where if you disagree with something, you can either resort to violence or go out and protest. Like, that's the, instead of just intellectually debunking the argument and kind of fighting it with logic and reason and critical thinking, do you think that people will kind of look back on this and say that, you know, that was obviously, this is bad, it was ineffective, it didn't work, it was inefficient, or do you think it will just kind of slowly tear us apart?
I think that it's going to be looked back on as not necessarily like a bad, like a, you know, the dark ages or whatever, but not a great time in America, but I really don't think it'll tear us apart. Mm-hmm. I hope not.
So you're hopeful that further generations will at least somewhat learn from it, maybe?
See, but that's the thing is I don't see the news organizations changing how they do news with just clickbait. Yeah. I also don't see celebrities changing their stance, and I don't see people not believing everything celebrities say as much as they do now. So it's dangerous. The only thing is, though, it's hard to really know because now with the way Trump's presidency went and
people spoke out.
Well, but just him getting elected, like the way he did it.
Yeah.
It was different. That opens the door, I think, for us to get vastly different choices for the next election. I think we're going to see a lot of people that we never would have thought we'd
less
see
less conventional
run.
Kind of presidential yes. candidates.
And so that, I mean, I really don't know. I do think we are, something's going to change in our country in the next 8 years.
Yeah.
Either with all of them being Trump or a reaction to everything Trump's done after 4 years, there's going to be things that are changing. I hope that the news organizations kind of die a little bit, and things like us, things like the Rubin Report, things like Crowder, Shapiro, like these independent networks get bigger, mm-hmm. YouTube gets bigger, people thinking for themselves increases because they're able to reach more. That's what I would hope would happen.
Yeah.
I have very little confidence in the average person here in America to be intellectually honest with themselves,
or to go in and do the research, even to even have yes. an opinion almost is like,
well, no, you can have an opinion, Jared. You don't have to do any
research. You can have an opinion, just not based in any knowledge at all. But yeah, correct. No, I mean, I totally agree with you. I would definitely like to see, I think we've kind of slowly seen people, obviously people get a lot of their news from the internet and stuff like that. But then you run into the whole fake news problem, which is obviously, it's almost like there's no winning, because you have the mainstream media, which, you know, can be clearly biased and not have certain stories and stuff that they cover, and then you have this whole plethora of information out here on the internet, and it's hard to vet what is real, what is not, what is true and what isn't.
Yeah.
But obviously I think that I would rather have that than have a news media where I get all of my information from, but like there's no other information other than that. I would rather have to have the individual responsibility to go out and actually validate the sources and validate
the due diligence.
Stories. Yeah, exactly. And then once you do that multiple times with a specific person or business, you can kind of start to trust them and what they say.
Yes.
But you know, I just wanted to get your perspective on that and see what would happen.
Yeah.
Obviously it's a crazy time, and obviously, I mean, the country's changing, so it'll be interesting.
I never would have thought free speech would be something we'd have to like defend, you know? It seems so ingrained and simple, but
exactly.
Maybe not.
And something that everyone would fight for.
Yeah, it's bizarre.
But instead, people decide to get triggered.
Yep.
Just like we're about to do. All right, guys, we're going to jump right into what triggered us this week. This is the place where we punch people in the freaking face when we disagree with them.
Like civilized people.
Yes. All right. All right, Seth, you're up, man. Go ahead and what triggered you this week?
All right, so this was just an amazing video. You guys have probably watched any of the bad lip reading videos out there. They've done with the NFL.
Yes.
They've done it with like Oscar awards. They've done it in movie trailers. But their latest one for the presidential inauguration was
great.
Absolutely amazing.
I'm important. Oh, you want to be me, don't you? Quite a figure. And no.
Looks like we have a problem.
Yeah, leave it to me. Okay, we're gonna squeeze him. Hadouken to your face. Harubububur.
Are you wearing a big boy shirt?
Yeah, I probably never will again. Help. I'm gonna barf. You ever washed that wig?
You got me again, George.
Yeah.
Good one.
That is a zinger.
I do not understand how they do it. Like, it's like you see it and you believe it's like this.
It and you look at the lips and it's like, wait, they might have
They're totally
been saying
this.
That.
It's so freaking good.
And honestly, and like, with this inauguration, how wild the whole election system is.
It's nice to laugh at it.
That, and also they might have actually been saying these things.
I love it, man. And like, they made like George Bush making like a joke, and Obama's like, "You got me." And he's like, "Yeah, I know."
Yeah.
Like, they make him like a kid.
Yeah.
And then Hillary, they made her just say nonsense.
Oh my god.
Yeah, it was
so
funny.
So it wasn't much difference than what she normally said.
Yeah, no, they didn't even change hers. But it was a great video. Links in the description. Check it out. It's totally worth your time. It's nice to laugh. It's nice to be a little bit lighthearted and just enjoy this piece of content. And these guys are awesome. And I hope they keep doing it. Because there's really just like a never-ending amount of content with this stuff,
I know.
Man.
I mean, you can do it with literally anything.
Yeah.
So,
what triggered you? And I think yours is
mine is not as nice.
Quite triggering.
Yes, this is. Well, probably my favorite show of all time, The View. Exactly. It's great. I love listening to The View. So this is a clip of Whoopi Goldberg's latest kind of really reasonable conclusion that she's come to.
I just remember we had this conversation yesterday. This was a point.
Oh, yeah.
So let me ask you now. We have a leader who has repeatedly demeaned women,
right.
Wants to defund organizations that benefit women, calling on the media to shut up. Specifically wants to give preferential treatment based on religion. Are these values really much different than the Taliban's?
All right, so did you know that Donald Trump is like the Taliban?
No, I need to write this down because he's like so many things. He's Hitler,
he's like the Taliban, so
he's like Stalin, I think I read somewhere.
He is, he's like white privilege, he's like misogynist, he's like racist, he's like xenophobic. This is insane. Equating Donald Trump to the Taliban, who throws gays off rooftops,
rapes
little women, little children. Okay, like this is not, it's not equivalent at all. It's insane.
No.
I can't believe
there's no situation where this is an okay statement.
No, it's not. It's totally, it's not even, it's not true at all. It's not even based in any kind of reason. And then freaking, what's her name? Joy Behar or whatever. Later
I can see that.
Later on the clip, she's like, yeah, no, there's no difference. Are you an idiot?
Yeah. And let's not forget, this is Whoopi Goldberg that always sticks by what she says. Get out of the country.
Yeah, exactly. She did say she was going to leave if President Trump was
elected. She said she would leave if Trump left. Trump won.
Please
go. Yeah, Trump won. You can get out.
Get out now. This is...
No.
This is insane.
And, I mean, just to, you know, kind of a callback to our main topic, yes, she's allowed to say this, but
I'm
guess
gonna
what?
Punch her in the face.
Our freedom of speech, we're allowed to say she's a freaking idiot, and she doesn't know what she's talking about.
This is true.
And any kind of straw or string she's trying to tie them together, she's doing it because it's going to make a headline.
Oh,
she's
doing
it because...
Well, it's going to increase their ratings. People have checked out their videos and stuff like that. I mean, that's how they've been on the air for 20 years. I can't believe that. It's crazy.
I did not know that, actually.
20 years, that's... 1997. How depressing.
Same people?
I think Whoopi has been on it that long.
Oh, my gosh. I just remember her from that Tic-Tac-Toe game. Do you remember that Tic-Tac-Toe game? She was not on That's So Raven.
No, there's a That's So Raven girl was whatever her name is. She's
on the Raven Vito. Simone. Yeah. She's another golden example of
another great
logic.
Childhood celebrity who came out of Hollywood.
Yeah. But
this is just another example of just insanity. So it's really all I can
fear-mongering, hyperbole, just
everything in the book. Could you imagine if somebody said that President Obama was like the Taliban?
I mean, I would argue that things were said very similarly about him.
Dude,
I
like someone of that stature on TV who's had their own program, who tons of people
would have been shut down.
20 years. Dude, it's seriously, like, there would have been insane rhetoric.
Yeah.
But anyways, that just, that drove me crazy this week. But all right, guys. We're going to go ahead and wrap up this week's Peanut Gallery podcast. As always, if you like this video, please like and subscribe. That really helps us out. Be sure and comment below. Tell us what you guys think about any of the stories we mentioned in What Was Nuts this week. Be sure and tell us what you thought about the free speech going on at Berklee College.
Or lack of.
Yeah, exactly. Or lack of. Didn't really happen. Tell us what your thoughts were on that. Be sure and check us out at your favorite podcasting service. We're on iTunes and we're on Google Play, so be sure and check us out there. Remember, guys, always stay informed, and we will see you guys next week.